legends and super legends. I've got about 5 minutes to get up there. I don't want to be late, so I'm rolling. I decided to do the prologue on the bike today. Crispy morning, it's about 9C thereabouts. Should warm up pretty quickly, so I've got arm warmers on. I'm going white and white today. Got my white helmet. I got my new white helmet that came in. My cat-like Mixino. Got it in white also.
So you can see that arm is rolled up on my sleeve.
Got my old Centini arm warmers on from the inner ring.
So I left the cycling room on the internet. Didn't roll the sleeve down because in the house it was kind of
many,
warm.
Many years ago.
And when I got outside, I just forgot to roll it down. But I catch it later in the ride.
It's a beautiful fair day, sun's out. So I'm not even bothering putting the light on. 7:28. Try to hustle and get up there. Alan committed to coming today. I know Paul's gonna be there. I didn't hear otherwise. But nobody else committed, so we might be surprised, but as far as I know, Paul and Alan, to expect. So all I've got on is my team kit and a base layer. Because within an hour, it's supposed to jump from 10C to like 15C. So I'm gonna bear being cool, a little cool, a little bit to start. But it's gonna be a nice warm day during the ride. We're gonna be anywhere from 15 to 18C during the ride. So. That's how you have to dress. You dress for what you're gonna encounter. And I checked the weather up until I rolled out the door. That's the way you do it.
Speed it up here. I'm on my way to meet Paul and Alan. Those are the two people that I know are coming.
Good morning.
Good.
Can't get my cadence to register this morning.
Cadence meter quit on the orange bike for some reason. I found out after the ride that the battery had some kind of oil on it. Looked like, I'm not sure how it got in there, but it was affecting the contact points. So it didn't work for the ride at all.
Alan had a mishap with his bike. His crank arm broke. So he's gonna drop it off for me to work on. The rotor crank arm just failed. He's riding a time trial bike today. P5. Good morning. Oh man, you got the same crank arm on this one.
Yeah.
Wow. Man, I'm telling you, I'm glad you didn't.
That's the first thing I looked at. I'm like, oh.
I'm glad you didn't fall, man. Because
I was actually on a little climb too, and then. I'm like,
yeah.
Man.
No, I'm glad you didn't fall.
Almost went over the.
Cadence meter quit this morning. For some reason, it won't be picked up. Never had any problems with it before, so hopefully it'll wake back up and get some cadence readings. But so Alan's here and Paul's here. We're rolling nice, warming up nicely.
Yeah, Paul kind of runs cooler than I do, and probably Alan.
It's already warming up, man.
Does so he's wearing.
It's already feel already.
Paul's wearing a long sleeve jersey.
Yeah, it's supposed to warm up quickly. It's a lovely day today.
So Paul's got tights on and everything, so I figure I would bear the cold for the first hour because it's supposed to warm up significantly in the next hour.
So yeah, it'll be.
I just put imbrocation on my legs.
Friend said, let's go get 2-for-1. So I just like, I don't know what you're talking about. Biggest concern was, I'm glad he didn't fall, because I was surprised, man. But they have Duralex on everything else. Right. Then they put rotor at the down, I don't know why. The rest of Alan's bike is Duralex. So we'll take a shorter way to get there, so we don't spend too many hours, you know, like we did the last time.
Okay.
So I don't understand why they didn't just put Duralex. He has Duralex on everything except down there on that bike. Today morning, God.
So we're talking about Alan's bike.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
The Cervelo.
Let him know. Thinking he wanted to come get it.
He's riding
he's
here.
P5 okay.
Has rotor cranks
here.
On it.
Yeah.
So does his Cervelo R5, the gray
we're
one,
good.
And the crank arm on the left
we're
side
good.
Broke last week while he was riding.
Yeah, straight.
He didn't fall, thankfully, so we're gonna replace everything. I'm gonna put Duralex on there. We're gonna get all the parts swapped out, and then once we get that sorted, we're gonna change the one on his time trial bike, because now he's paranoid about riding the time trial bike because it has the same crank on it.
Yeah,
the aluminum fatigued.
When you go backwards, it tilts up a little bit, like it's adjusting. Which is sweet because it used to cut your head off.
That's why sometimes it's good to stay with the well-known manufacturers.
There you go.
That's the thing. I don't know what's going on with the rotor crank. But here I hand the camera off to Paul. Ride up to Alan. We're still warming up. We've been riding for about probably 20 minutes. Warmed up pretty quickly. It's actually feeling warm. There's not a whole lot of wind today for a change. That's nice. This is where I'm fixing my sleeves. I finally realized that was out. If the cold air kind of got to my heart. Because in the house it was warm. I rolled out with it, rolled up a little bit. Take a shorter route. We're gonna go out to Ridge Lake Shores today, and we're going to take a more direct route. It's a route that we did with.
Yeah, I know. So far, nothing.
Yeah, Paul's trying to tell me that his cadence meter is not registering as well. So for some reason, he's got a similar challenge. I used this bike at the Spirit Ride 2 weeks ago, and it was fine. So anyway, but once I got home, I found out that the battery had some kind of solvent on it, which was affecting the contact. I cleaned it and it started working, so didn't even have to replace the battery. I don't know how the solvent got in there, but who knows. So we didn't have cadence registering on this ride. It's the metric there, and then the timer was not working. The software was very glitchy as far as that timer was. But anyway, so we're going more direct to Ridge Lake Shores. We want to keep the ride around 3 hours there about. We end up doing a little more than that. But this direct route gets us through the woodlands quickly. We can get out to Ridge Lake Shores and ride those hills. And then we'll come back. We're not going to come back on that busy highway. We're going to take a different route, which I think is more interesting. It's a quieter road. It's not as busy as the other one, although it's narrow. But I think it's a better way to come back right now until they finish the construction. So right here, we're kind of easing into the warm-up. I look for traffic. Nothing's coming. I had listened to an interview a long time ago, some of the old school cyclists, and I've always liked wearing white socks with white shoes. It just seemed to look cool. That almost makes it look like you're wearing boots or something. It just seems to blend better. So I decided to go white with the white helmet. It looks pretty good. I was also tempted to do the white gloves, but I couldn't find them this morning. I'm not sure where they were. So I went with black. Reaching for something to eat. I always keep my solids near the edge of the pocket closest to me. I start with those early in the ride, and later in the ride I just use gel. Once I'm going hard, I don't want solids. Check for traffic is clear. It's a four-way stop sign. So the granola that I'm eating, the granola bar, I did a video where I showed it. We get it from Sam's. It comes in, there are two sticks in the one package. And I basically eat, like, I split them in four and eat a piece each time. I don't like to have my mouth full when I'm riding. So just a mouthful each time. So I still have it in my hand. I take my time to get through. This is a very mild morning. There's not a whole lot of wind, which is unusual for us. This road goes up. It does not register, but it might be like 0.6, 0.7. I'm in a 5319, something like that. I'm riding my Shimano C35 wheels today. They're a little more aero than my other wheels, than my Campagnolo Zombies. The thing I like about them is they're quiet. They're part carbon and part aluminum. The braking surface is aluminum. And what we're talking about there is, Alan said this turn that we just made, that was where the crank arm broke last week. He was going up that climb the other way. So I was just very happy that he didn't fall, because those kind of things, you can fall. I read online somebody had a similar issue with the rotor crank and ended up breaking, you know, some ribs, just falling when it broke. Needless to say, he doesn't want him on the bike anymore. Everything else is Dura-Ace, except for the crank arms and chain ring. So I'm going to take him off the bike and source the new parts and get them replaced. I was giving Paul a hard time because I thought he forgot our logo, because he saw those arm warmers on me, and I thought he asked whether this was our arm warmers for the team. I guess I just misheard him. That's what we're talking about. So here Island starts to go, and we start to ride in earnest now. Been riding for about 30 minutes. Good enough for a warm up. You can see my little trash can there. I just finished my granola. I took my time, I ate it. I always keep the trash under my jersey. Then when we get to a stop, I dump it. Because the wind is so calm today, we ended up setting a bunch of PRs on this ride. I didn't realize it until I loaded it on Strava. And a guy named Stuart commented that we had set a bunch of PRs. But we ended up getting out the Ridge Lake Shores like almost 20 minutes earlier than we did last Sunday when we rode with Christian and Elena. So we were moving today. Right about here we're doing like 35, 36 kilometers an hour. Slight grade right here. Really didn't sap our speed that much. Chase finally. Because that sun being in my eyes on this stretch, we're headed east, helped me remember that I had that thing on the back of my head.
Got a change.
The yellow's already gone. I looked, there's no cars coming, so I was letting the guys know I was going to change. So I didn't even unclip. One thing about this intersection, it always picks up bikes, so they did a good job, whatever they did with the sensors there. Significant wind this morning. Clear, move over. So we're gonna be turning left up here. Flint Ridge.
Let me see the little light that usually blinks.
I'm looking at that cadence meter to see if I see any kind of light on it. That little accelerometer, that's what I use for my cadence.
Is this kaput?
Does it have a battery in the sensor?
Yeah, it does. We usually have a tiny battery, though. That kind of stuff. So yeah, I'll start with a battery and then it's just
starting. Usually there's a little light that blinks, I don't even see it.
Thank you.
here we head towards the Flint Ridge Hills, the rolling hills, anywhere between 3 to 5% thereabouts. They're not very long, but they come repeatedly. It's a nice area to ride. I like coming down here. It's a good workout, guaranteed. It's not too far. There's never any significant traffic out here. So any day of the week, any time of day, same density of traffic, which is not much. So the first hill is in the distance there. We're rolling in a 5319, 5317 thereabouts. And we really don't do much shifting. Right here, it starts to go up. Basically zone 4 effort. Spray anybody behind you. Since I knew we're gonna be slowing down for the stop sign, use the opportunity to move on. Alan checks and we're rolling. This is where we would usually turn right on the other route. Today we're going straight. We're headed northwest, and with this direction, we'll be able to get out the Ridge Lake Shores without spending too much time getting there, and so it might end up being a 3.5 hour ride as opposed to 4.5 if we went the other way. So the hill kicks in again here, it's another roller, and we put the pressure on. Well, I was gonna swing off the front, I guess. He's talking about his crank arm. He's real paranoid about it after what happened with the other bike, since this has the same thing. So this week I'm gonna be procuring and sourcing his replacement for the other bike. Once that's in and set up, then we'll do the same thing on the time trial bike. I'm gonna go all Dura-Ace. He's got Dura-Ace on everything else, so I put down. Just go Dura-Ace. The main manufacturers, I haven't had problems with their crank arms breaking. And I've got Campy, Carbon, I've never had problems with them breaking. So the rotor, really, he had them on both bikes, and he doesn't want to keep them. I don't blame him. That thing snapped. He lost a piece of the aluminum.
Talking about MSA. Here. You know, if that happened to you, it's going to bring.
Paul doesn't like to stop, so he noticed the light is green. He's letting us know so we can keep going. Once we get going, Paul doesn't want to stop. This part of the course is, it'll say zero and it'll say minus one. When we're riding it, I didn't feel that. If you look at the angle of the camera, this road is going up. There, now it says 1%. It's really odd how it does that, because the whole time we're riding this thing, you can feel the drag. It's a false flat. This whole area here, it felt like we're climbing. We kept the effort pretty high. This is zoom 4. We get a drink there. Turn circle, traffic's coming from the left, nothing's there. I check right, it's clear. Let everybody know. Once you're in the circle, you got the right of way, but I still check to make sure nobody's coming in. to time this light to where we won't have to stop. And it works out pretty well. Steady here. This road is a false flat, as most of these roads in the woodlands are. It says 2% there. It's a drag. I shift down a cog or two of it. Now it's standing in this gear. Four-way stop sign, I thought it was clear. I see that car at the top of the way. Once he goes through, it's our turn. Reroll. I get my gear rolling again. What's unusual about this morning is that the winds are fairly calm. You can tell how quiet it is. And we're making really good time compared to other times that we've done this route. Calls the all clear. We're gonna turn left. This is research forest here. We're gonna be headed west of research forest. General direction of Austin, briefly. It's got a nice wide shoulder, so we're using it. The other side of this road, the opposite direction, is very narrow. In the past, we'd see riders that would come on this side of the road, riding on that shoulder just to avoid traffic. I was telling Paul that we're improving our time. Alan takes over. Get up on this wheel, and we get to the business of riding. You can't see them very well, but we just kind of alert people just in case some glass or something. This is Honia Egypt Road. We're going to turn right. This is the road. We'll take a little shortcut to get out to Ridge Lake Shores. And this road that we're on, the right lane is all chewed up and poorly patched. So whenever we come here, I use the road. Mentioned that to Alan. He'd been at the front for a while. You can see I'm dancing on the pedals. I'm nicely warmed up. So I just go ahead and take the lead shortly. I just kicked it up and I went past Alan. Yeah, right about here. That's why I like to stand. Sometimes you can carry a heavier gear a lot easier using your body weight. You can see the right lane on this road. It leaves a lot to the right side of this lane. So I'm using the middle, pointing out all the... It's just chewed up over time. There should be bumps. So you can't ride on the right very comfortably. It's not very busy this morning, so you just used to go. Quickly we clip in. That's something we practice. You should be able to do that.
What was that? It looks like he dropped something, Alan.
I think Paul thinks Alan dropped something, but Alan checks.
You okay?
Yeah, everything's okay. So he didn't drop anything. And I'm waving, there's a car behind us. Waving them by. So we cut through this little neighborhood. We turn left here and get back to the main road, Hornia, Egypt, which becomes Fish Creek Thoroughfare that will take us to Ridgely Shores. Not sure what we're talking about here at this point. It's getting a little warm. I'm adjusting the arm warmers. Debris down here. There's a bunch of stuff on my shoulder. I had looked behind. There was nothing. Nobody using this lane. This lane ends. So we stay on the shoulder because the shoulder continues. This is very busy. This is the Fish Creek Thoroughfare, it's called, and it's under construction. We're not going to come back the other way like we usually do. We have another route that will bring us to the light we just passed earlier. We can bypass this construction zone by using another road called Hornia, Egypt. It's kind of a cutoff or a bypass. So we're going downhill here. I'm just, whatever gear I'm in, I'm riding it to where I can still feel the gear a little bit. Keeping my cadence reasonable. And you see Alan's just rolling in the draft on that bike. That bike's very aero. There's a lot of debris here. Look like parts of craters. That. Nothing significant. Not what we're used to. It might be 0 to 5 miles an hour, probably 5 miles an hour. Not much wind. At this intersection, Alan asked if we were going straight. I told him, yep. So he takes over the lead. Bit of a drag, it's not very significant, but I stay out of the saddle, get my gear rolling. I think I stand back up once it starts going up a little bit. Yep. So it just eases everything, it makes it easy, it keeps the bike very lively. I like that feel. If I'm in a gear, I can accelerate it if I need to. Have to practice in and out of the saddle. You got to be able to handle it. When you're out of the saddle, you want to be in a cog or two higher, because your cadence will drop a little bit. But you want to be in a gear that, should you need to accelerate, you can. You don't want to be bogged down even when you're out of the saddle. Always use gears that you can handle. Why you have to train in harder gears when you plan to ride. What I mean by that is, don't spend the whole day training in, say, a 53-21. When you know you're going to be riding with people who you probably should be riding a 53-17. So you want to spend short intervals in the 53-16 and 15, so that when you're sitting in the 17, it doesn't feel that big. And that, you know, that comes with time. It's not going to happen overnight if you haven't been doing it. You have to condition yourself first, and then you have to progressively train. Some of the workout plans that I put out for people that I remotely work with focuses on the gear you're using and the effort that they're putting in those gears, whether it's heart rate or power meter. But the bottom line is, if you never ride those gears, don't expect to be able to do it. I sped it up here. We're sitting at the light for a bit. As we go through this light, we get a couple of impatient guys. I heard him rev his engine, so I looked back, saw him. Came by, and his buddy passed another car in the grassy median. Just shook my head. kind of decisions they make that create problems. It becomes part of the statistics. I stood for quite a while here. There's a lot of times when I train, especially when I train solo, I spend a lot of time either into the wind or up a climb, out of the saddle. Your heart rate goes up quite a bit, so you have to get accustomed to that so you don't overstress your engine. You're not as efficient standing out of the saddle as when you sit, but sometimes it can be a benefit. You use the power from your upper body to get that bike moving. And we're getting close to Rays Lake Shores here. Looking to see where the construction barrels are. There they are. Yeah. And you can see the gravel on the right. That's the where they're going to be widening. That's going to be the new lanes. So now we have to turn across the gravel at the top of the hill. And I kind of told everybody about it. The gravel is hard, so that's good. It's not like sand, like you see the mountains. So you don't have to worry about your wheels getting swallowed up at this entrance anyway. You always have to be careful when you go across gravel. Sometimes you might want to unclip if you think it's soft, because if it swallows your wheel, it stops your momentum. Right here, we know it's hard, but we still go careful. Here 20 minutes ahead of the last time we came, last Sunday, when we came with Christian and his wife. We're fighting the north wind. It took us 20 more minutes to get out here than today. So we can ride for about an hour 20 and be out here and ride these hills and ride back home. That's kind of cool. Telling Alan about the team kit arm warmers that are on the way, gloves and so forth. He's gonna get us up. Paul was telling me to watch out for the pothole. Cut the edge of it. Right around here, we spot a deer. Yeah, right there. Paul said, watch out. He saw the deer. That's the deer there going across the road. And the thing about them is they don't know how to cross the street very well. And that might be a second or third coming, so you got to be careful. Cross the road as badly as cats. I mean, dogs cross the road really well. I've seen them stop and look just like people do. Cats just run. Cats, squirrels, deer, I don't know what else. They just run out there. I was telling them about the last time we came here, the deer were chasing each other.
Yeah, when I see when I always just slow down, man, because the next one is near.
They don't know how to cross. Cars hit them all the time. This is our little Mont Ventoux here. This may not be very long, but it bites. The cool thing is today there was no car at the stop sign in the middle of the climb. If you have to stop there, it's tough getting started. I'm in a gear that I can just handle, so I speed up and slow down the gear as I see fit. C see how I'm holding my bars very lightly? See my fingers on the sides just hanging? That's how you're supposed to be. You're just guiding. And I kind of hook under the brake levers if I need more leverage. You can see I'm accelerating. Same here, no problem. If you want to be in a gear you can dance with. Taking the bike for a walk. I learned that phrase a long time ago. When you stand, you're taking the bike for a walk. We got up to the base of zone 4, up that little climb. Backed up quite a bit before we got to it. It's a nice climb. One of those climbs when you go hard is a separator. You can break up the group. We start the roll here, and then I think this is where Alan takes off. Yep. We've been rolling for a couple of minutes and he takes off. This is like a downhill minus one. It's on that time trial bike. I'm behind Paul at this point. I end up coming around him. Somewhere about here. Yeah, right there. I come around him, but then I noticed that Alan had backed off the power. So I just kind of kept it steady. Figure we got a hill coming up. I'll save my energy for that. Just kind of ride it. Yeah, Alan was asking the direction. Paul's laughing at me. I told him straight. Roads are just well paved. They did a really good job of paving. Closer than he appears. The camera with this wide angle makes it seem further away, but he's not. Shifting down, I decided to spin up this climb. So I'm probably in a 53, 21 or a 23, something like that. Because I have up to a 27 on this, 28. I'm using my Shimano wheel, which is a 1228. I'm probably in a 23. This, we're still talking. This is the bottom of zone 4, top of zone 3, close to sweet spot. It's a good length for a climb for us. Here we start to chat about Christmas shopping, Christmas trees. My wife's into it.
Because I don't climb the house and put no lights on. Forget that.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. But she's into the season. Oh, man. Live and let go and hire these guys to climb up there. And you hire them to climb the niggas out. Oh, man. That's a big commitment. All right, I don't climb it up there.
Tree. I told her for $200 they ought to come with a gift. And here we head south on Egyptonia Road. Instead of using that highway that was so narrow, we take a parallel road that's a little west of that highway. see the speeds keep going up. Every time we get a little more shelter from the little wind that's out here, the speeds go up. There's no light until we get to where this road hits Fish Creek. It's a straight stretch, good exercise potential. This for quite some time. Following Alan, that you can see I'm not really close. I don't want to see around. This for several miles at this point. I haven't briefly looked back. I thought I'm gonna pull off, but then he resumed. So I just held my position. We really rolled back into town fairly quickly. At this point, I wasn't aware that Paul had decided to let us go. I'm not sure what was going on with him. But we weren't going super hard. It was kind of hard, but he can handle it. I had noticed when he started to ride, I don't think he got enough rest, really. His family and everything around. It's been crazy for everybody, so it's part of it. I pretty much thought he was there, and then shortly after, here you see Alan looks around and asks. There. So then I look back. I can see him in the distance. The camera doesn't show him very well. We turn the power off a little bit. Pull into this little street here. And so I told Alan, I hope he didn't have a mechanic.
Hope he didn't have a mechanical. I hope he didn't have a mechanical. You okay? Keep going. He's good. Yeah, let's go.
Good spot in here. We get behind this truck. I think we stopped at a store shortly after he started taking off some stuff. He may have been a little warm. A lot of stuff on. busy road that with the barrels that would have no shoulder on the way back. So we took a detour that brought us back to this road. So we avoided the construction zone with this road. The road we took is okay if it's early in the morning, and the afternoon is kind of busy. So it worked out. So Alan said he needed to stop for a bit. I know Paul doesn't really like to stop much. So, hold in here. I think Paul was not aware that Alan needed to stop. So he said, why are we stopping? We could just keep rolling.
I think he may need to fuel up. We're not gonna sit long. Ah! It's warmed up nicely. You okay? Not too hot?
No.
Okay. Alright. Yeah, take some stuff off if you need to. Yeah.
So I basically set the camera on the trash can and went in and got us some Gatorade. And I just kind of sped it up here. Half of the group ahead. Turns thought they were not really riding together per se. I think they just kind of happened on each other out here. Kind of like we came upon. These two guys are together. One is on a time trial bike like Alan. So we're just rolling with them. We're going to be turning shortly. So we're getting off this highway to take much more scenic routes. Stay on this highway, all you deal with are these cars zooming by. So something more picturesque. So we're going through the woodlands. And there are more hills in the woodlands. Roll with these guys, and then pretty soon we come across one of the guys that had fallen off the pace from the group that ran the red line after this section. I move into the lane, I check for traffic, there's a dip in there, and we hit it. Just right, Paul had a flat there one time, so I'm always conscious of that. It's one of those that are gonna hit. It's not obvious. Give you a pinch flat. It's a small dip and always has stones. But right around here, I think, is where we came across the guy who had fallen off the pace. Yeah, right here. And we get off of that highway, it's kind of boring just sitting on a shoulder for miles and miles being passed by cars. So we only use it as a connector. We'd much rather take these other roads that are more rolling, more sedate. It's just more interesting, really. So this road will take us to Taramont Parkway. The strap on this shoe just kept coming loose. I looked at it when I got home. I don't know what's going on with the Velcro. It kind of was annoying. One of my other projects to figure out. There's always something. back to make sure the lane was clear, moved over. I sped it up over here.
Not any car stopped there.
Right here, as we go through Allen Foot Slips, right there, and he says he's a little paranoid about that crank horn. I told him, I said, yeah, that's why I want to get your other bike fixed as soon as possible, because it's going to be on his mind now after what happened with the other one. Rightly so. That's not the part of the bike you want to be unreliable. Takes the lead again after we get through the intersection. This is a slight downhill to flat, it's flat now. And we're rolling. I'm just keeping my cadence high because we got a lot of hills left. We're gonna go through the Flint Ridge Hills on the way home. And that's the way you have to use your head. You have to think about what's coming. And by keeping your cadence high, it keeps your legs fresh. Have to be able to tolerate high cadences. You have to have conditioned your body to deal with high cadences. You can't just go out and start doing that overnight. Traffic jam here. Everybody's turning. So I took the whole lane so no one would come by. We're going straight. We're not turning. I thought that guy on the left there was going to turn in front of us. I mentioned that to Paul. He looked like he was going to turn and then he stopped at the last minute. Hill kicks in. Put the pressure on here. That's what I talk about, the terrain. If you use the terrain wisely, you get the work you need. Slow down for this car. He starts to go. Check, it's clear. And roll through. So I decide to stand. I always like standing when the terrain changes. I've always been like that. I go around Allen. Pace is about 181 beats per minute. How much power that puts out. My power meter at this time. When you are using power meter, it's good to use it in conjunction with a heart rate monitor so you can see how much power you're putting out at certain heart rate zones. That's another way you can gauge your fitness improvement. Or a decrease in your fitness. intersection, I tried to wave that guy over, but he was just slow going, so we just went. I wanted him to go. So we stayed to the side, and then he came by. He had the right of way. Didn't want to lose our momentum. Down this hill in about probably a quarter mile, there's a right turn, and it gets to like, I think it's 2 or 3% in the turn. So I downshift because I didn't want to stand up. Ash Lane Parkway. Lane through, downshift, I mean like a 53-25 or something like that. So I've got a 28. Alan comes around, I just slip onto his wheel. You see my cadence is up. Because in about an eighth of a mile, this road goes left and it goes up. I'm not sure what I was looking at. I think the chain was making noise or something. I ended up dealing with it when I got home. There was something going on with the front rear. Way back there, it was rubbing. Right here, the road begins to go up, and we start working this clump. You look at our speeds, 37 kilometers an hour. This, we're on the climb now. It may not have registered, but I can feel it. It says 1%. It's more than that. We're working this clump. You can see it's in earnest. We're moving. 36 kilometers an hour, 1 to 2%. Good effort. Error. gives me more control than anything. When I'm drafting behind somebody, I don't like to keep my arms parallel, even when I'm on the tops. I like to sit like I am right there so I can see over and around the person I'm following. I'm still pretty low. Take the lead and basically prepare to take us home. We're in the Flint Ridge Hills headed south. And the first one you see in the distance that it goes up to 4.5%, but it gets there in a hurry, so you really feel it. It's not very long. This is now 3 hours into this ride. pressure. Pretty much what we did on Saturday. A little over 3 hours on the road, riding time. We're out there for probably 4 hours, but riding time is 3. Hope you all got a chance to get some cadence.